questions.
So good morning, everybody. We're going to start again with day number 12. These are the subjects of today. Today we're focusing on testing and some other things that are, well, sort of related. One is the layout of the source, how you should structure your source and put comments in it. That's related to the visibility and the readability of your code. And the third thing is security tests, so how you can do specific tests on your smart contract, but then for security. So the first tests are just functionality tests, and the rest are for security. So tests, who has experience with testing software? Well, everybody has, of course, because whenever you write software, you just have to test it, otherwise it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Christina, what kind of experience do you have with testing?
Yeah, unit testing.
Unit testing. Mm-hmm.
And what's the other one called? When you test your database, it's not unit testing, it's called somehow else.
Okay, database testing.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm going to focus mainly on unit testing because that's the most specific for Ethereum. And there are lots and lots of types of tests that you can do. It's an entire science testing software. So you can your job can be only testing software. I know a couple of people who do that. So if you really want to test pretty well, that's difficult. But I'm going to focus on the unit testing and the security testing, of course, because that's the most specific. Unit test. I'm going to explain a few methods, and the core is all the same, but the way you do it is slightly different. One of the easiest way is to use Remix for unit testing. They have a module built in for unit testing. You can find it over here. Over there, if you click on that button and then select the Solidity unit testing, then you get this screen where you can run tests. And here are a few examples for the unit tests, and you can find them over here. What you have is you have your smart contract, one that you want to test. And then there's a separate smart contract which has the same name but with underscore test behind it. And in that one you create your tests. And you do that by creating several functions who perform tests and then a few special functions who you can use to initialize your tests. So for example, you can do a before all and that initializes everything before all the rest of the functions are called. And then via the module you can run the test and then you see something like this and a couple of green bars for tests that succeed and maybe some red bars for things that fail. Now with the special functions, here's another one before each. There you can do some preparations for your tests. For example, this one is done before each test. And here they've created a small counter, E. And every time that's put a bit higher by being incremented. So this way you know in which test you are. And for example, for the second test, where I is 1, you can set some value at 200. So then you can do a test here to check that the value is 200.
So that counts for all the tests, basically?
Yeah, yeah. So if you have multiple functions here, then this one corresponds to IS0, and here IS1, and then IS2, 3, 4. So then you can more easily create your test and create special test use cases. The best is just to try it out and see what happens. So that's of course the assignment to do that. Here's one example for a safe math function. So the first test is a straightforward one. Actually, it's a case where something goes wrong, but it's tested what happens. So you take a value of 0 here, and then you subtract one of it. So that ends up at -1. But because it's an unsigned integer, it wraps around, so you get a very high number. And that number is 2 to the power 256 -1. And here they're checking if you indeed get that value. So yeah, that's what happens. So the checking you do with a call like assert.equal. So that assert is the assertion, the checking of what you want to check. And then equal is of course to check if the values are equal, and you have also like not equal or other variations. So you have the two parameters here, which you're going to check, and you have a string which you're going to output to show if something, what goes wrong and what doesn't go wrong. So for example, this one will succeed, so that will return basically true, that it's fine. And then in the screen output, you see the same string as over here. That's the unsafe subtract in the flows, which it's supposed to do. So this is a very simple test. But you also can do a more complicated test. And that's if you do a normal subtract with the safe math library. And the safe math library checks for that problem that we just had, so that it's that you go below 0 with the uint. So this is part of the library, safe math. And if you look at this function subtract, then it first checks if b is smaller or equal to a. Otherwise, you would end up with a negative number. And then it does a require on that. So if that doesn't work out, then the execution of the smart contract stops. And that's fine for your normal smart contract, but when you're testing, that's not so handy, because then your test doesn't continue for the following test. So in your test, what you want to do is to catch the fact that it's erroring, so that it stops. So you need a special construction to do that. And that's the construction they've created over here. And what they've done here is a fairly complicated way to call that function. Basically at a low level way, where you low level encode the values that you're going to send to that function. And this helps to continue after the require stops over here. And then there's another trick that they've done. That's if you have a library, we haven't really discussed libraries, but libraries look just like any other contracts on Ethereum. But your libraries, there are actually two ways of libraries. And a library can be a real contract on the chain, but it can also be included in your smart contract, so that only the functions of the library are used. and they don't end up at a separate contract. So that's more like other programming languages. When you include something, it's really embedded in your software base. And if you have internal functions in your library, then it's included in your in your source, basically. So if you want to use this construction, where you go to call a function and check if the smart contract stops, that doesn't work in combination with this library. So for this test, they have created what they call a proxy. So that's a sort of extra layer on top of this to call this function. So if you look at it, it's just called contract saves mod proxy, and it just directly calls this function. So when you're making your test, then if you try to do it just with the library, it won't compile. So you will immediately be triggered that it doesn't work. And then you have to remember, oh, there was some trick I had to do, and the trick is this one. Is it clear? Sort of.
So this is the code that the test that is used by the SafeMath. So by this is the standard library SafeMath.
Yeah, this is standard library, and this is a test. An example test from Remix to test this library. Yeah. So, yeah.
And this plugin, does it generate the test script for you? Or?
No, not really. I have. Yeah, actually, there is a button.
Test file, yeah.
Yeah, if you go to the. To the interface, and you have your normal file that you want to test. You have a button to create a test file. So you think, well, that's very helpful, and that creates my tests for me. And luckily, that's not quite true. You get something like this. So it creates a test file, and it has some functions, test functions. So it has a sort of a template which you can use. But it's not really related to what you're testing, so this is always the same.
Also, this is only a template.
This is a template
that you can use.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. But it's a good starting point, and you can take this one and fiddle it with it a little bit and change function names or whatever, and then connect with your own code. It all sounds rather complicated like this, but if you do it, then it's not really just something.
Same syntax, so that you have a before all function and then uh-huh. You have the unit tests.
Yeah. The before all, usually you just initialize the functions and call the constructor or create your contract that you want to use. And then continue with it. Yeah, if you run the standard example, then you get a few error messages, as it's supposed to do. So this is nice as a template, but not otherwise. Here are a few of the functions that you can call. So you have the equal and the not equal, and you also have just okay, so that you can check a boolean, and you can also use lesser than and greater than, so compare values if they're smaller or greater. With these functions you can sort of do most of the things you can think about. I noticed when preparing this, sometimes Remix just didn't work anymore. And then if you look at the developer console, you can see error messages like this. And then you have to reload Remix to get it working again. So if you get strange results, then it could be that it's Remix and it's not your fault, but it's Remix fault. So Remix is sometimes a little bit buggy. Now I've taken one of the pieces of Solidity that I've made for this class and used that to do some testing on it. And while I was testing it, I noticed there were even some errors in this smart contract. So even in a relatively small contract like this, like 30 lines, you can already have quite a lot of mistakes and errors. So even small parts are quite important to unit tests. What this function does, is, by the way, is you can register yourself if you're joining in something or not. So you enter, you call the participate, and then it remembers if you want to join or not. And it stores this in the mapping and in an array. And then I've created this test file for it. I've hit it before each, so that's done before each test. And the first thing I do here is that I create the contract. So I have a new instance of the contract, so that every next test I have a new one, so that it doesn't conflict with between the tests that I do. And then first here I'm checking if the number of participants is zero. And of course it should be zero at the start of the contract because nobody has used it. So this is a sort of way to practice with this interface. And in smart contract I've also made it so that participant number zero has address zero. So I'm also here double checking that, just to make sure that it's what I expect it to be. And then I can do some more interesting tests. So for example, here I'm going to test what happens when I add one participant. So I call here the function participate with true. So that's I'm myself are participating. So then you expect there to be one participant. So that I'm checking that here, I'm retrieving the number of participants and checking here if the number is one. And if it's not, then you get an error message. And the idea is that actually all that you can think of your smart contract, you should check. And as you can see, this blows up quite quickly. You for one function, you have already four lines to test it. So if you have a large smart contract, you have quite a lot of unit tests. So
you should keep your units small.
You should keep your smart contracts as small as possible and as elegant as possible. Mm. But it probably takes more time to create your unit tests than your smart contract. But the good thing is that, they call it test-driven development. So if you develop your contract and in the same time develop your tests, that's a good way to, create your software and create your smart contract, because you test it in the same way. You have to start think more precise what you're doing. So that's a good way to do that.
Even though people say that they start writing the test and then the coding.
That's the ultimate of test-driven design, that you start with your test, yeah. That's true.
But does that make sense in Solidity?
Sorry?
So how would you do that? And, because then you still need to understand what functions you need, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, you can. What you can do, I've done it before, that you first define the functions that you want. For example, here you want to add a participant, and you just create a function like that. Here, to the previous slide, and you start with an empty function. There's nothing in it, and you create a test on it, and you just run the test, and then you expect, of course, it to go wrong. but that already gives you information that you have the right syntax and the right variables and whatever. So then you can start building up your code by at the same time improving this and improving the unit test. So every line, whatever you make here, that you immediately also make unit tests. And the bigger idea, of course, after it with this is that if you use development pipelines with GitHub, etc., that every time you upload something to GitHub, that the unit tests are run at the same time, and that if you run a test fail, unit test fail, that you cannot upload it to GitHub. So that you always have a correct version on GitHub. And if you have a mechanism like that, you can more reliable create and deploy software. Mm-hmm. So here I'm testing everything I know about what is happening. For example, here I'm checking participant one, and that should of course be myself. So I'm checking the owner of the contract, that's myself, and the first entry. So these two should be the same. So then you can continue and check everything that you have. And then after that, of course, when you add a participant, you can also remove a participant. So that's the next. Hey, so that's the next function test that I've created to remove a participant. And this, with the before each, every time I create a new smart contract, so I have a new smart contract for this and before this one. So I start out actually with the empty smart contract, and then I'm trying to remove a participant. And there was no participant there, so it wouldn't really remove anything, but it also shouldn't give an error message. And then as the third option, I'm first adding a participant and then removing a participant. So then you have the next situation. So, but this is not even a full test of that smart contract, because I'm now only testing it with one participant, and you should test it, of course, with more participants. And I haven't done that in this example.
So how do you build up such a test plan? So you can mirror out of the functions that you have in your contract.
Mm-hmm.
That's one thing. And the other thing is that you need to test for things that may go wrong. Do you test on the purpose of making it function or making it safe? Do you have different tests for that?
Yeah, you can of course look from different angles towards your goal, but mainly unit tests, you just take the function that you want to test and test all the invariants. Then if you know what our invariants are. Okay, an invariant is that's quite an example. Let's say we have let's say we have a logic like this, where you increase one variable and we decrease another variable, then x plus I should always be the same. And that's what is called an invariant. And in an example like this, that's obvious that it would be the same, but in more complicated situations, it's not so obvious. So this is typically something that you can do in tests like that, and to check every time that the invariants, things that always should be the same, are the same. For example, if you have a banking application, then the amount of money that you have in your application should always be the same. If you get it from lower the account of one person than an account of another person should be higher. So that's how you can build up those tests. And of course, there are entire testing methods that you can use, like TMAP, for example. It's a method to design tests. Okay, now I've created the test file, and I'm within still a remix, and I'm running it here by pressing this button, and then this happens to work. They are all green, and of course now they're green, but while I was developing those tests, I had frequently that a few were red, or I get something that I didn't expect. So creating this, yeah, takes quite a lot of time. Now, as you remember, I'll go back to the sheet. Here we had a difficult in construction to call another contract and to catch the fails of the contract. And recently, Solidity 6.0.6 has arrived. And they have new constructions to catch errors and continue after that. So I made a small example on how you can use that. And that's, they've created a try catch construction. And you have that also in JavaScript and other programming languages. So you now also have something like that in Solidity. You still need a proxy. Because this library is a library with internal functions, so you need a proxy to be able to call it as an external function. So that stays the same. But now you can just call that function here. So I'm here calling SaveMetProxy, so that's this one, and that calls this one. And I can just enter some parameters in it. And then if everything is fine, then it just gets over here. And then you can just return, in this case, true, because it's a test function. And if you get an error, then you end up in this situation, in one of those. And if it's an error with where a string, a reason is given with a string, then you end up over here. And if no string is given, then you end up over here. So in both these situations, the test didn't succeed. So I return false for this function. And then the test environment knows that something has gone wrong. So this is a nice trick to make your tests somewhat easier.
So how does that compare to the assert functions in the other methods?
So you can call assert around this to be able to interface it to the test environment.
Yes, so in the previous test you used asserts.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And now you use try and catch. How do they relate?
Yeah, you have to wrap that assert around this function, actually. So actually I should have written here assert and should have used assert okay. And then call this function in my assert, okay.
And that contains the try and catch.
Yeah. but this is relatively complicated functionality, but it's nice to know that that this exists. So you don't really have to use it, but it's just that you know it. Okay, so till so far it was all within Remix. And by the way, the assignment is to create a unit test for your own smart contract and use one of the ways that I'm explaining. So you could use Remix, or you could use one of the methods I'm going to explain now. And what I'm going to explain now is how you can do the unit test in Truffle. So Truffle also supports unit tests, and they support actually two ways to do unit tests. You can do the unit test from JavaScript, or you can do the unit test from Solidity, or you can sort of combine both of them. And both also use something like assert.equal, like before. Only difference is this starts with a capital A and this one with a small a. And here it was with a capital. But the results are the same. Here for Solidity you have a few more options that you can use, a few more assert functions. But the trunk doesn't really matter all that much. And here you also have a lot of functions. There are even too many functions to list over here. But they all have at least the standard equal and not equal functions. Now you also have the initialize functions, like the before all and the before each. And by the way, you also have the after all and after each, so at the end of your tests, so you can clean up things if you want. Now, you have an example from the examples from Truffle. One of the example smart contracts is just a mini coin smart contract, where you can send coins and get balances of coins, and they're going to test that. But first I'm going to use the JavaScript interface. And as you might remember, within Truffle there were a few ways to access your JavaScript. They have something you can use web3.js, but they also have a sort of simplified version of web3.js. So we also use that to deploy the contracts. But you can also use that same thing in your unit test. And the way to do that is that you have the contract name and the contract function with some values. And if you do it like this, you can create a transaction, and if you put call in between, then you use the read-only version of it, so you only retrieve the value. So you can use those two. And this is the example unit test they have created, in this case in JavaScript. So you see here that they deploy the contract and do different functions. So here getting the balance, here sending a coin, and you can see the syntax is a little bit different, because here you have also a call where it says it and then a string. That string you will see in the output. And you have the asserts equal here again.
So yeah, what you do when you are going to develop it, you just copy paste an example like this, and then you adapt it and you reuse the syntax like that to just build your code. And then when you want to run it, you use truffle test, and then with the file that you want to run, and it first compiles your contracts, and then it runs the tests, and here you can see in the output the results. So it says here should put 10,000 MetaCoin, and that's the string from over here. Yeah. So these three are those three. And in this case, everything goes fine, so you don't see any additional strings. But if anything goes wrong, then you see one of those error messages that you see over here. And then if you look at the directory structure of Truffle, it's the same as when you have a normal contract, with the contracts over here and the compiled versions over here and the migration over here. And you have an additional directory where you put your test files. So this was the first version using JavaScript, and you can also do the test in Solidity, so that looks more like the test that you do in Remix. And you create a Solidity test file, and it looks a bit like this. First you have to import these two libraries. And this one contains all those assert functions, and this one is used to get the contract that you want to test. So I'm not using here the before all type of functions. They are also there, but I'm using them in this example. And here in this first test, these are the tests that are being called by Truffle. And here it gets the contract that you want to test. So it looks up via the deployed addresses the contract. And then it calls some functions over here and checks the result with an assert equal. So here it checks if you call this function, that the balance is 10,000, so this variable. And if that's not 10,000, then you get an error message. And here's it's actually testing the same, but it's here is deploying a new instance of the contract, just to show that it's possible. And also checking the amount is 10,000. Okay, and you can run the test again. It's sort of the same syntax, also truffle test with the Solidity file. It compiles contracts and it shows the green marks when the tests are okay, and if it's not okay, you get a red mark with the error message. And this test is also put in this directory here, the test directory. And Truffle can do both of those tests. If you just run Truffle test without a specific test, then it runs all those tests which are in this directory. So both the JavaScript and Solidity tests. And it runs like this, and you get the green marks if all the tests go okay. So you see both of the tests being performed over here. So in total, 5 tests.
So how do they compare these two methods? The Solidity and the JavaScript?
Yeah, in JavaScript you can do, it's a more powerful language, so you can do more advanced things. So if you, especially if you want to do things with interact with the environment or whatever, then JavaScript will be fine. And if you want to purely test your solidity, then probably this is easier because you, I think, less statements to do your test.
No, so if you want to do pure the smart contract testing, then solidity is...
It would be fine, I think. Yeah.
Fine. And if you have a whole environment, then maybe JavaScript.
Yeah. But yeah, otherwise I think with both you can do more or less the same. So just, yeah, experience, try with it and see what you like the best. There are some additional libraries, by the way, where you can also check events. In the standard test, you cannot really easily retrieve events. But with this library, you can. So if you want, you can do that. Okay, then... Because unit testing is so important, and because also the smart contracts are relatively easy, relatively small, people have been working on making the testing better and more automated. So there are tools, for example, this tool, who can automatically create tests for you. So it can analyze your source, and it can distinguish different test cases. So that can be quite useful so that you don't have to do all the elaborate work. But it sounds better than it is, because when trying this, it also took a lot of time to get to know the tool and to get something useful out of it. But it does work. So with a simple contract like this, it was able to figure out all the test cases which are relevant in this situation. And yeah, you can see them over here, all the values that is found with these values. So for advanced things and bigger projects, this could be an interesting thing to use. But I think it's a bit too far for this course to go into this. So it's just that you know that it exists, but you don't really have to try that out. Now, some tips that I found about good unit tests. They're over here. You have to make those tests short. If it's too complicated, too long everything, then it just doesn't work anymore. And for example, they also have to be fast, because if you have a development pipeline, you're going to run your tests very frequently. Basically, with every change that you do, you're going to repeat your tests. So they have to go fast and give good results all the time. So that's why they also make them deterministic, that they always give a simple, straightforward, good result. And your test is also a piece of code, of course, so you also have to test your tests. So it's extra work when you create tests. Yeah, you should design them, of course, you should think about it.
An agreement with proposition over inheritance?
Yeah, that I tried to figure out what they were thinking about it. I've found a link here that explains it more. And it's you can inherit things from other contracts, but that can get pretty complicated. And they say, well, you better can split it up in smaller pieces and only use the pieces that you need and not take an enormous thing and inherit everything from it, because that gets easily too complicated. So it's basically breaking up your code in smaller pieces. Okay, that was it about the unit test. I think it's now good to try it a little bit. Otherwise, it's just too much theory. And it's, if you just do it, then it's probably easier than you think. And if you get stuck, then I can help with it, of course. So then in the afternoon, we'll continue with the other subjects. Any questions at this moment? Okay. Okay, let's continue. I've taken a look at the one I showed this morning with the Solidity 6 test and try, and I've adapted it a little bit with and put the asserts in. And I figured out that I draw this morning is best to put assert in and call this function, but it's actually easier to turn it around and put the asserts in this function. So then, especially here where you get the error message which you get back from the revert, you can take that one and put that here. So in this example, this is the smart contract. I've put a new string with the error message, and you see that same string now printed over here if you subtract one from zero if you go into the negative. So this is a simple way to use that if you need. Okay, now we're going into the source layout. There are some specifications or suggestions how you could best lay out your source so that it's easy to read for everybody. So it's a best practice to do it that way. And that's written in the Solidity documentation, how you can do that with a couple of examples. And one of the first things is the order of how you order things in your contract. So at a high level, you should use this order: first pragma, then import, then interfaces. That's for if you want to call other contracts, especially old contracts, then libraries, and then contracts. And then within those things, use this order. So use first the types, then the variables, then the events, and then the functions. And then you also have different types of functions, and this is then the order you're supposed to use for the functions. So first your constructor, and then your fallback functions. There are actually two types of fallback in the latest versions of Solidity 0.6.
What's a fallback function?
Fallback is if you call a function and or call smart contract and the function name isn't specified in the list of functions, then it goes to the fallback function. So which is useful for proxies and to catch whatever functions that you haven't defined. And then afterwards, first external, public, and then internal and private. So if you're going to write your contract anyway, it's easiest just to use the specified order. Then they also have some naming conventions for functions and modifiers and all those kinds of things. There are two main ways to do that. Is start everything with a capital, and then like this, add more words but start with a capital,
And there's the mixed case where the first one is not started with a capital and the rest is starting with a capital. And the idea is then that with all sort of the high level things which you put first, like the contracts and the structs and the events, that they all start with capitals. And everything that's related to functions and variables, that you start with the mixed case variable. And Robert, you just said, but I haven't seen it in the documentation, that if you use parameters in functions, that it's the best practice to use underscore?
No, that's more, if you use it locally, that's more best practice that I saw.
Okay. In the consensus.
Distinguish between global and local variables and functions.
Okay. Yeah, I hadn't seen that one before, but it's also useful. Yeah. And the last type is all uppercase, and that's what you're supposed to use for constants, so that you can see easily recognize a constant value. So this is, well, sort of similar to most other programming languages. And there are also some suggestions for example, how many blank lines you should put in your source. For example, if you have multiple contracts, then you should have two blank lines in between. And here are some suggestions if you have really long names, how you should format that with indents so that it's also easy readable. So there are quite a lot of those minus miniature details, which you can see over here. But if you use this, then it's for others a lot easier to read your contract. Now, not only there are specifications for the layout, but there are also some standards to supply more detailed information, which you can use to generate documentation about your smart contract. And that's this type of format. So it's a triple slash. So normally comment would be a double slash, so this is an extra slash. And then an at sign with there are a couple of things, like title and author, and here are some more information about it. So the idea is that, for example, for a function, for each of the input variables, you can explain what they are. And also with the output variables, you can explain that. And you can also explain the function itself with things like this, the author. And there are, you can generate two types of information. You can generate developer information and user information. So if it's specially for a developer, then you can say the at dev thing. So that's the more technical information. So the idea is that you, in your smart contract, should document your functions in a way like this. And it's also the assignment to adapt your one of your smart contracts and add this. And these are all the tags that you can use. So title, author, notice, dev for the development, and then most important actually the parameters and the returns. Now once you have that and you compile your contract, then it can automatically generate and collect all that information and create a structured format out of it. So initially it creates a JSON format, like in the play editor you can see that over here. If you click here and scroll down, then you see the dev doc and the user doc. And with dev contains a bit more information and user doc, only the general information. So you can use this to see what's the output. And in Remix, you can even generate markup documents, so a readable document which
takes all that information that you just saw and make it more readable. It takes a lot of clicks to first enable the plugin actually, and then to use it, and then it finally generates this document, and it's in a markdown format, which is for example used in GitHub and in other places. And if you take that file and put it on GitHub, for example, then it shows like this. So this is quite a readable output. So you can use this to check if you're if you have useful information. Well, in Solidity 0.6, there have been one small improvement on this. Because the return values in all the versions you could only use one return value, and in the later versions you can specify all the return values in separate lines, so that's better. So even if you use an older version of Solidity, you can still write it like this and make multiple lines for the return values. Maybe if you probably didn't notice that, but in this one is created with an older version of Solidity, and here it has taken those two lines with H1 and H2 and just concatenated them together. So if you use an old version, that looks like this, and in the new version they will be separated. But the Remix Markdown plugin doesn't support it yet. Now what you can also do is run the Solidity compiler and also get the information out of it. This is where you can download the compiler, which is called SOLC, and then you can run SOLC on your file with the parameter user doc, and then that creates that JSON output that you saw before. So could be situations where that could be useful. And if you specify them the dev doc, then you get this version. And you can see here that the two returns are specified separately. There are also a couple of tools who can import this configuration and display it in different ways. And the expectation is that in future also things like MetaMask will also be able to read that information and show more usable information if you call a function and want to sign something. Mm-hmm. So it's good to do this anyway. Is this clear to everyone? It's straightforward. Okay, now we're going to continue with the security tests. Last time we had security in general, and now I'm going to focus how you can do some security tests on your smart contracts in an automated way. So just put it in some tool and then you get an interesting output. The simplest one is the Solidity Static Analysis of Remix, which I think is even run by default, and it checks for a couple of possible problems. And if you run it like this, then you get this type of output, and there are more general warnings or more explicit warnings than just from the compiler. So it's always good to have a look at that and to see if there are things in there that you should fix. Maybe you cannot fix everything, but it's good to have a look at it. Now, a little bit more advanced tool is called MIT, and it does more security verifications, and you can also use that from within Remix. And it's also a plugin which you can activate, and once you have that, first you need to compile your contract, and then you can within the plugin click on analyze, and then it takes a little while and it generates a report with a couple of suggestions. So yeah, you can look at those suggestions and fix them. And this service, the people who made that, they of course want to earn money with it. So if you run it like this, then it's doing a couple of checks. Then if you take an API or log in at the site and use their API, then it does some more, I think. And if you pay for it, it checks even more. So if you are really developing a smart contract professionally, you probably want to use the paid version. It's, I think, a couple of hundred euros per month. So for a company, that's not much, but for a hobbyist, that's quite expensive. But the free version doesn't really show that much interesting things, but it's quite easy to run, so it's always good to do that. Now here's another tool that I've found. This is quite easy to use and gives a little bit more potential problems. You just go to this website and you can click here and then paste your source code. Then it's analyzing it and then you get things like this, also messages, which you can also double check. Now, here's another tool that I've migrated over quite a lot of those tools, and they all have a little bit different perspective. So it's good to have a couple of tools and run a few of them and to fix all the error messages. Here's a so-called linter, which is basically checks your source and also finds some security issues. It also finds things like trailing spaces, for example, which is not that bad, but it's best practice not to use trailing spaces. So you can install it like this, then you have to initialize it and you can run it on your Solidity file and you get some output which you can check and fix. There are also emerging some tools which can check smart contracts, especially the token contracts. Here's one for the ESC20 contracts, which is made by Ernst & Young. So they're just probably trying to profile themselves that they know about Solidity. Here you can also copy paste your smart contract and then especially your token contract. And I've put in the example token contract, which I made as small as possible. So I made a few shortcuts in there. So I would expect to get a couple of warnings. And indeed, it shows a couple of warnings. So if you run a scan, and here you get an error. And I click now on all those things above and you see there are actually quite a lot of things that failed in the test. Over here and over here. So that means that the contract is not perfect, which I already knew, but this helps you to figure out in which places it's not perfect and to fix it. Use yet another ESC20 verifier, where you can enter your address of the smart contract, which has to be verified on Etherscan, and it also does some checks on it and also shows some errors. Now, if you want to deploy your smart contract for real, then of course you're going to do all those things that I just showed, but you probably also want to get an audit done. If there's a lot of money in your smart contracts, then it's best to do an audit, although they're quite expensive. And larger projects even ask multiple auditors to audit their contracts. But yeah, they use an approach like this. They run also a lot of those tests that I showed before. They also do a threat analysis that we saw last time, and they do all sorts of checks. And that usually they find at least a couple of things, and sometimes a lot of serious things. So it's quite useful to do that. And here I've collected a couple of audit reports from different companies, so you can look into them and have a look what kind of things they're looking at. So that can also give you inspiration when you're creating your own smart contracts to see what to look at. Now here's a list of problems that can exist which have led to different attacks. And here are a couple of other security tools which are different from which I just showed, which each can find a couple of those problems. So this shows you need to run multiple tools to get a high coverage. And here in this link I've collected about 20-30 of those kinds of tools. Okay. So these are all the assignments that I've created for you. So the first one was to make the unit tests, which you've been doing this morning, and to run them and make also, so put your unit test on GitHub and also run the test and make a screen capture of the test, so that you can see that you've run it. Of course, add some NetSpec comments to your smart contracts, and then run your smart contract to a couple of the tools I just showed. So, two of Ethereum, of Remix, the smart check, what was that again? Yeah, and Ethlint. I'll double check with what this one was. The idea is to run multiple checks on your smart contract and see what's going on.